Okay, there we go. Yes. Do you consent that I do record this call for the purpose of uploading this in my YouTube channel, SA Infotainment Podcast only?
No problem. No problem.
Are you happy today's proceeding in court? Advocate Mshololo cross-examining Colonel, Left Colonel Mangena. Are you impressed?
Yeah.
Because I will tell you this, right? You had some concerns about how Nxumalo was handling things, and then today you reach out and you're like, Mshololo. I'm like, okay, come, Ozanas. Are you interested? Are you happy?
No, I'm happy. And remember, like I said, she was hammering on Nxumalo's point that he was trying to emphasize yesterday. Remember what I said about Advocate Nxumalo. He's got too much respect that for me is not good for my liking.
Okay.
Especially when you see somebody is deliberately disrespecting you. So somewhere, somehow, you need to be able to put a stop to it, and you need to be able to stand firm and say no to any kind of abuse.
Okay, now let's go to Mshololo again. She takes things step by step.
Yeah.
And then the man is like, "Aye," she's like, "Relax. Step by step." Right? And the man is like, "Oh, relax, advocate." One of the
Yes.
questions that, okay.
Okay, I was saying yes. If you check the witness over the stand, like I said yesterday, he wants to put this thing of saying I found matches and I was 100% correct. So when you ask question, he doesn't answer the question that you are posing to him. He just answer something that he wants to answer. So at least today, Advocate Mosholo was able to say no, slow it down. We are still at 6.1, so let's take it step by step. And I don't think the presiding officer was happy with that. And even the witness, I don't think he was happy with that because they knew that she wants to land him into a trap. So they are not even so sure whether the witness will be able to read through the questions and be able to answer according to the script that he was prepared allegedly.
So if you look at 6.1, for instance, when you are listening to Mangena, what he doesn't answer the question in relation to 6.1, but he goes further, and then he says, no, focus on the at the end, do not focus on the piece on 6.1. And Advocate Mshololo was like, come back. So of which again, Advocate Mshololo says, my understanding of the report is that there was insufficient individual characteristic to give a positive match. And guess the response? The response is that's correct. So there was a first report that was negative. Mangena, I wouldn't say it was negative. The class characteristics were there, but insufficient for me to say it's a match that I wanted to shoot additional tests. What's your take? Because for me
Look.
here, okay, I'll give you now, but for me here, in life we don't have just like generally in life, it's either you are coming in or going out. You can't say there was a lack or the, no, there were some characteristics, but not enough. For me, not enough equate to negative, because here we are looking for positive. So in the absence of positive, we must be left with negative. What's your take?
Look, what the witness was trying to do was to try to confuse the record. If you check on that 6.1, it's when he was saying Rulof found a match, and when I come here, if you check, it was a match. Then that's when Advocate Mosholo said, no, we heard about Rulof. We want you. We want your testimony. What did you say? That's when he had to come to say things that he wanted. He didn't want to say that there's no, it was inconclusive. You understand? So he didn't want to mention the word it was inconclusive because he could see that that's where she's leading him to. And then now the follow-up question was, why after finding that it's inconclusive, which is it's not a match, why did you have to do to do another analysis or to do the reshooting? Meaning, if you do the reshooting, you wanted the match, so you are going to shoot up until you get the match. That's what Mosholo was trying to tell him, that you wanted to shoot up until. That's why she asked, "Who did you tell? Or that now I didn't find the match. Now I'm going to do the reshooting again." And that answer was what did not come forth. He just said, alone, he just decided. Then, is it credible? There's integrity there. No.
Then Mosholo dealt with the integrity of the exhibit, which we'll deal with it later on. Then Mosholo says, further, you said that a result took, you said, as a result, you took a decision to obtain a further test on the same material exhibit, which is what you have just said. Mangela says, that's correct. Mosholo says, so, Colonel, with that, look, with that means that there is a difference. There's a difference in bullet material. It means that you have an impact on the examination or transferring of marks. you see, here it got me a bit of confused. But Mangela says that's correct, my lord. Mosholo. And why did you take a decision alone to obtain additional test of the same material exhibit bullet? Because reports were inconclusive here. You examined an exhibit and you had and you have gotten findings. Mangena says it's how we normally work. If we shoot the test and find the test you are comparing with a different material, we prefer to shoot a correct test where you can do a comparison on a similar object, not different types of object. This is where I was completely lost and said, Mangena, maybe you understand him. What's your take? Because I was like, what exactly are you saying here?
Look, that's where I'm saying the trap came forth here, because you got the findings that these are not match. You did your test and you find that there's no match according to rulers matches. So why do you go and try to get the match? So he said that his reasoning was okay, because I was using the HUD, the FML, and I didn't get the mesh. So let me go and use the CMJ, the softer one. Maybe, probably, I'll get the mesh. So what Mosholo was trying to show to the court was, this witness, he was going to shoot and shoot and shoot until he gets the mesh. As long as he doesn't get the mesh, this shooting was not going to end. He was compromised. He was not objective. He was compromised already.
He was looking for actual result. Unless otherwise he gets that result, he's never gonna rest.
Yes. If you check, Mosholo said, number one, I agree with you there. You found the mesh. Remember this one. This time around in the second test with the CMJ. Right? The CMJ.
Yes.
So now, Mosholo said the marks I agree with you there. Now we are on agreement. And number two, they are visible, both sides. I'm with you there. Then he was happy, yes. But now, on number three, they don't agree. And you know why? Because they are not there.
Okay.
But that's where you see why he was skeptical or he was reluctant to use the spirit level. Because with the spirit level, on number one, because the marks are clear, it was easy for him to use that spirit level. They call it water pass. Everything is going to be fine. And on number two, he was able to use that spirit level. Then coming to number three, because the marks were not clear, there was no way he's going to use that spirit level. And he disputed the spirit level because he knew that I'm going to fall to my sword.
You see, this reminds me of an incident that once happened to me. So there was a point where I was driving. I was on my spare time, I would do Uber. So I was busy doing Uber. I would drive around what's this place? I forgot the look. I still remember it's Eden Park Police Station. I was there on a certain day. So I happened to pick up a person that, according to the police, they know that this guy is a drug dealer. Oh, he sells drugs. I don't know what's the difference. But yeah. So now they realize that I have him in my car. And mind you, I picked him. When I went to pick the guy, I passed them. Maybe 500 meters, I stopped and I picked the guy. And they could see who am I picking. These guys, they see me leaving. I see the car is following me, you know. So we drive, and then they stopped us. We stop. They search the car. They find nothing. They search his bags now. They find nothing. They let us go. They follow us again. We drive maybe 2 kilometers. They stop us. They search us again. They search his bag. They find nothing. They let us go. We drive 2 kilometers away. They stop us again. They search other. That's what I said. Guys, this is abuse now. Now they're abusing us. But now, you know what I'm saying? I could say that they are looking for something. But Monday, because they can't get it, they are disappointed. And they think, I maybe see it in some way, we didn't check. Let's go check again. I think that was a similar situation with Mange.
He was going to shoot until he got the marks. But unfortunately, the CMJ that he used, it didn't transfer all the marks that he wanted. Like number three was not clear, number four was not clear, and number five was not clear. Number five, the right side was lower and not clear, and then not equal. Therefore, it's not matching. And number six, and then he says the right also was not clear, was sliding and was higher than the left side and not clear. So he only found the match on number one and number two, of which it was not enough. And remember, last year he said we found matches on number one and number two. This year he says six. So those six, because number one and two was not enough for a match. It was supposed to be at least six and above.
So then Msholo says, let's conclude from the examination you did on the exhibit from Roloff's evidence test. Did you not get the positive match? Mangena says, my lord, I have mentioned due to difference in bullet material, I could see the individual characteristics, but But they were not sufficient, so I can come to the conclusion that with this bullet, it is inconclusive. So I needed to shoot correct tests to compare the test. Msholo, it was inconclusive. Look, am I correct to understand if the findings in 6.1 were inconclusive, there was no positive match? Mangena, I will say correct, there was no positive match, but it was an inconclusive finding. You see, the reason I'm reading this is because I find it very weird that if you listen to the DNA expert, the DNA expert, he never justifies answers. He will say, we tested here, it was inconclusive, we move on. Heck, why do you have another expert who does... You know what? Why do you have another expert who comes to court and justify his answers? Why can't we stick with this? If it is inconclusive, it is inconclusive and end there. Why do you want even your answers? Here, he should have just said, yeah, it was inconclusive, and it ends there. No, it was inconclusive, but it was an inconclusive. Why are we justifying an answer? I usually say, when you ask a question and the person doesn't answer you, or when a person doesn't answer you, but rather they justify their answers, then there's always a problem.
Correct. The role of his job, or for him to come to the witness stand, was to make things simpler, not to justify anything. Whatever the terminology that they were using there, he was just have to come and explain, okay, when I'm saying striations, I'm talking about this. When I'm saying this, I'm talking about this. Therefore, now, this was non-mesh, and then the reason of the non-mesh was because of we used different bullet, then I went again and book it out, and this was this person signed. But him is doing everything on his own, doesn't follow procedure. But anyway, I think it's enough for him, because in that courtroom, no procedure is followed. Everything is new.
And who has the thing? You know what, this is... Okay, continue.
Because if procedures were important, and laws and rules were important according to the standard of South African courts, the presiding officer was going to say, wait a minute. So are you saying to me, you went and take that gun and then sign it? Who did you sign? Who was there when you were signing this thing?
That is exactly what I want us to, when I say, wait a minute, that's what I want us to, just let's have time on that one. Advocate Msholo says, she interrogates this very nicely and says, let's follow how you took the gun, how you got the gun.
Which is the procedure.
Yes. And Advocate Msholo arrives at the point where she says, but do you notice that it's only you who knows or who is doing things, who's signing this? The administration block in the SAPS does not know or does not have any track record of anything or anything that you are doing. And then the answer from Umangena, it says, but I was there. And I'm asking myself, are you the law? What is the purpose of administration if when you are saying, I am there, but I was there? Talk to me about that, because I find it very strange to think that just because Mangena... Okay, let me give you a context again. Do you remember when, I think it was Brigadier Bongani Kinin. Do you remember when he was asked about why did you guys take the gun? Do you remember his answer there?
I can't remember.
His answer was, things do happen at the SAPS. The gun would have got stolen. So they took the gun to themselves.
You know what? Remember the ballistic defense ballistic expert when he was in court to receive the exhibit. You remember what he said?
Mm-mm.
He said, no, I'm not allowed to take this exhibit here. They must bring it to me at my office. Of which, according to the procedure, you are not allowed as a ballistic expert to take to drive around with an exhibit, because we don't know what will happen along the road with that exhibit. So they wanted him to break the law, and he said no. That is why now the defense is hammering on the procedure, because what needed to happen was they were supposed to bring the gun to Mangena, not him to go to the SAP-13 and collect the gun. No, it's not procedural.
You know why I wanted us to talk about that? It is because, do you remember in the evidence of Umsia, do you remember when he was questioned about the chain of evidence? Do you remember what he said? Hey, he said, he said that when you collect an exhibit, you must drop it at the nearest police station, we take in Yakon. Then they will transport it.
Yes.
But in this case, Mangala says, I was there. And to me, it says, oh, so you are the law.
Yes. Hence, Mosololo said, I don't have those powers that you have, that you can be able to bend the rules.
Exactly, because I was sitting there and I was like, wait a minute. Mosololo has highlighted something very important here, that these people were willing to violate procedures just to get things done their way.
Remember, I'm allegedly, of course, I still believe, in my opinion, I still believe the witness, Mr. Mangena, now is the mastermind. Even if you listen to Mosololo when coming to the collection of the exhibit at the crime scene, he was so specific that Musia didn't find anything, but the following day you guys found a bullet. Musia was not mincing words when he was saying, look, we looked, there was nothing there. Of which, that is why I think they asked the question, what kind of a gun did these intruders use today? Because if they used the 9mm pistol, they were going to find cartridges. And the revolver came into play. That revolver was supposed to be the order of the day. But now the script has changed. And who changed the script? The script changed by a Gininda, 2018, when he was involved in this case. Because from 2014 up until 2018, it was a revolver. Then when Gininda came, changed the script. Then now Mangena understood the script that, oh, okay, now if now we are talking about a 9mm parabellum, then we can easily get somebody who was convicted with a 9mm parabellum and then pin that to him. You understand?
Quite interesting. You know what? Speaking about the issue of the gun, the 38 versus the revolver. I have a video that I'm going to share with you. I'm going to share with you. I'm going to share it on the channel. Where Msiya is being cross-examined by Advocate Defo, Msiya says, the gun that was used in the commission of this offense was a 38 special. I have it on record.
And you know why he was saying that? Because they told him, because they wanted cartridges when they got there. They wanted cartridges. What kind of a bullet was the intruder having? They were in possession of a gun with a wheel. That was the answer from the house. Then now, there's no cartridges. Then they went with the story up until Brigadier Gelinda came into the case, allegedly changed the script. And he forgot that on his own affidavit, he wrote 38 special. Then now, how many people now that are having revolver? There are very few.
Mm.
And now, especially the people that are committing these crimes, most of them, they are using parabellums. Where are they getting them? Allegedly, they are taking them from the police. They kidnap police and take firearms. Then they use those parabellums.
By the way, we'll talk about that. I think I need to bring that research. There was an article that was released about the guns that were taken or stolen or whatever word you want to use it, from police. Yo, it is alarming.
Yes.
I read
yes.
it on an article.
Yes. So now, they just want to spin it. Because they had people, okay, there are these guys who were convicted with murder, and this gun is about to be destroyed. You know what? Let's go and use this gun. Say this. Unfortunately, that bullet, it didn't cooperate. The one that Mangena used, it didn't cooperate.
If you are not yet subscribed, what are you waiting for? Come on, good people. Because to subscribe, it is free. To like the video, it is free. To comment in the comment section below, it is free of charge. To click the notification bell, it is free of charge. To share this video, it is free of charge. To watch this video until the end, it is free of charge. Also, good people, I mean, come on, to watch the ads, it's free of charge. And that's how you financially contribute to this YouTube channel. Speaking about financial contribution to the channel, you can join, become a member of this YouTube channel from as little as 20 rand a month. You can also use the Super Thanks button. In case you don't want to do that, guys, there is a way where you can use my media company banking details to donate to the channel. And you know what I'm saying? We'll bring you more. And also, guys, want to buy more equipment. So the power is in your hands. Please do the honorable thing as we proceed.
No.
Then Advocate Msholololo says, now we are going to see how many consecutive matching strays were there.
That's where the number one was matching, number two was matching, number three there's no agreement. And did you realize on number four he took time on? It was like he's not there, it was like he fainted because there were no matches, there were no lines. He took time to resist. And that's when he said, they are there. I see them, my lord.
Advocate Msholololo says, let's agree to say they are not that clear. And Mangena says, I can see them. You say you cannot see them. Me now I can see them.
And the other thing was when the judge says because you saw them in the microscope in depth.
Oh,
but
yes.
Yesterday he was able to see them where he was. Maybe today he forgot where those people
are. Yeah,
then, okay, fine. On that one, is he going to convict? Because we are sure that he's going to convict those guys. Is he going to convict these guys based on something that he could not see, and then on the assumption that Mangena saw them in the lab? That's the question that I'm asking. Is he, because on the exhibit they are not there.
But
so
listen,
is he going to...
But listen to Mshololo then. Mshololo says there was a chart that was created for this court.
Yes.
To see. So if there was a chart, then we can't, when you can come here and say we must rely on what you saw at the lab through the microscope or in by microscopical. We can't rely on that because you brought an evidence now that we should all see and relate to. And in fact, that's the purpose of an expert, by the way. An expert is somebody that must bring in information that is relatable. It's an expert is somebody that must break down difficult things to a language that a layman must understand. So if you are found wanting in your own language, in your own sphere, in your own field, as you are trying to break down things, then there's a problem. And before I let you talk, I remember somebody once said, if you are a teacher, and after you have taught your students, they are as confused as before you started teaching, that person says you are not a teacher. Move away from that field. I mean,
remember,
let me allow you to speak.
Remember, on that note, what Mshololo said, my Lord, there is this exhibit. It's even written a court chart. Is an exhibit which is called a court chart, meaning we need to work on this exhibit. If there's no clearer marks on this exhibit, we cannot now assume that there are clearer marks somewhere that we don't know of. So that's when Mbaloi was saying, no, it's not fair. I think Mshololo was 100% correct. And the other thing, she even said it to him, meaning your evidence is not reliable. We cannot rely on your evidence, sir, because now we have to think that you saw this thing at your lab. Then it's not true, it's not reliable. You brought unreliable paper, and they could quickly pick up that, we are discrediting even the evidence that was brought to court. And this this court is going to work on this chart, and we cannot again bring another one. So there, I think Mshololo did well. And I don't know why the presiding officer, Rata, has to introduce microscope. Why does he have to bring microscope?
Ante will talk about Rata, but yeah. Otim Mshololo, I put it to you that there were I put it to you that on the strain, as indicated, that it's not a local visible strain. Therefore, it means it breaks, and therefore it does not give consecutive marks, which you count from 1 to 6 matching strains. We've already covered that. He said what he says. And then Mshololo, I'm saying between strains number 2 and 3, there is a break because there was 3 strains that do not line up or match on other side. They only appear on the left side, and they do not go up. Look, they do not go to the right and side. And then he said what he said, which I do not agree. You also indicated other marks are not clearly visible because barrel was worn out. Yes, that's Mangena. And as a result, the marks were not transferred consistently into the test. Correct, the barrel is worn out and there is a slippage. Inshallah, we are in agreement with the straight one. It straight one lines up and visible on both sides and the same width. Number two, we also agree visible both sides. Number three, we worked on. Number four, it's not clear. You see that there's no strength. You see, this is what the reason I'm going through this is because this is what I find it weird. I find it weird that Advocate Mshololo is basically saying to you, to this person, listen, to an evidence or in an evidence that we all can see, do you see that we don't discredit you because we just want to discredit you, but we disagree because factually what you are saying, it doesn't make sense. For the fact that...
You are simply saying, according to the standard, if you want to say it's a mesh, it has to be at least a six or two of the three consecutive, meaning a group of the, maybe in if the lines are three and the other group is there are three, then these two groups, they have to be, they will be, make a match. But now, when you're saying on this one, first line, first group of these two, you can't even get a six consecutive, then how do you say it's a match? Because he was saying it's a match. Instead of saying inconclusive, like the report, the first report, the findings on the first report, on the 6.1. On 6.1, he was clear, it's inconclusive. I think back then, he thought that they will find maybe revolver somewhere. Unfortunately, they couldn't find the revolver. So they had to change. You understand? So she was crediting, she was saying to him, that is not a match. It is inconclusive. You need to stick to the law or the procedure or the formula of finding that formula, they call it CMS, I think. She said it's a CMS. That is the second. They said the other one is when they use the chart, and the other one when they use the triacent, the CMS, and the other one, as I forgot the chart, what. But now, she was trying to tell him that you fail to follow the procedure, of which it's not something new for him to not follow the procedure, because even how you handle the gun, it's not procedural.
You understand? You see, there's something that I find it very strange, right? You see, when the DNA expert came to testify, there's one thing that as I was listening to him, I could feel and I could tell that this guy, he doesn't give a damn, not even a swimming pool. He's just here to tell what he knows. And then bese kuba umtshali from SAP 13. Mchali was not there to defend himself. Now you can tell that Mchali doesn't give a damn, not even a swimming pool. All Mchali care about is to answer the question you are asking him. And once he's done, yes. That is also what I got from the DNA expert. He's just answering questions based on what he knows and what he studied. He was never there to defend himself. But you've got witness.
Don't forget that Colonel Mangena, he said he's not an expert.
He said he's got what?
He said he's not an expert. He said he's an analyst. So the expert thing comes from Russia and Russia.
I do remember, I'm sure to ask you. But nonetheless, still he is a witness. I'm saying,
yeah.
I'm concerned about the attitude of the witnesses. They get into the stand as witnesses. Witnesses are supposed to get into the stand and tell us what they know, what they saw. Not to defend yourselves. And it becomes a problem when a witness is now defending what they have said or what they have seen, then it's, you are no longer a credible witness. And that is what I'm seeing from Mangena.
Okay. What do you expect? Because if you check now, that this case is about everyone is defending.
I can't hear you, Yazgata, now. I don't know why.
I'm saying, what do you expect? Now everyone here is defending himself or herself. The case is no longer about Senzo Meiwa. It's about defending the individuals. Mangena is defending himself. Balo is defending himself. Even the presiding officer now is defending himself for, why did you take this long? I mean, there's no case here. And he sees that there's no case. So they have to. If you can check, when he says he's asking the clarification question, he asked, did you go to see the body at a forensic?
Yes.
Was it that ballistic related? He was just trying to discredit Mosholola about the measurement.
Huh.
That's what he was doing. He was covering up the potholes, because now he was answering Mosholola when he was saying, why did you go and measure these guys? Then Rata said, okay, because you didn't answer this thing correctly, you were supposed to say to Mosholola, I even went to go to see the diseased body at the forensic. It was part of the policy. So that leaving the measurement is part of the ballistic. But now, because the witness knows that it's not part of the ballistic, that what the presiding officer wanted him to answer the question. You are supposed to say, I even went to go to see the disease. So he was trying to cover up.
Mosholola moves on and say, the reason why I'm taking you through this exercise is because there's an exhibit before court, and ultimately this is an evidence before this court which depicts the strength. Look, you were able to see when you were being examined. Look, when you were examining it in the microscope. Otherwise, it wouldn't have been here before this court. So those are some of the interesting things I personally observed in the Senzo Meiwa case today. But I like the fact that Advocate Mosholola decided to say, no, I know you've been cross-examined by Advocate Mgomezulu, Advocate Mnis, who spends a lot of time with you, Advocate Nxumalo, but I want us to go back to the basics, because the key is in the basics. If we can just go back to the basics, then we can get it right. And for me, she got it right. What's your take?
Look, when she was talking about why did you bring this document here, remember, they were never in their mind thinking that the defense will get ballistic experts. It was going to be water under the bridge. It was going to be a walk in the park. He was just going to say, remember last year he said he found two striations because of the mesh. He wanted only two. He said, talked about only two. But now, because the expert is in the house and he knows that two is not enough, it's supposed to be six or seven or eight. So now, he comes back when he was cross-examined by Ramosipi, says, I found six, so that it can meet the standard. But the six is not sixing on that chart. He only found two, and it was not enough. That is why he brought that document, because remember, the defense knows nothing about the ballistic. So they were just going to say, we found two, it's enough, fine. Then there is a match. They couldn't anticipate that the defense will want to expect.
Again, that will speak of, you know, sometimes when you tell the truth, you live in peace, eh? Because then you don't have to anticipate anything. If you are telling the truth, you don't have to anticipate anything. All you need to do is just be yourself. The rest will take care of itself. We will not have been in this mess had some people spoke the truth from the beginning. This was never necessary. Telling you.
Yes, I agree with you fully there. But that's why I'm saying that document landed in court because they didn't anticipate that there will be another expert, not an analyst, but an expert. Who
okay.
will say, no, this is not the procedure. Must find six. That's why when he was talking to Ramusipi, he said, no, six. He changed the script, five, six. He said, start talking about five and six, of which they are not there.
How do these people look or think of us? Are we supposed to be dumb? Not to see things that are there? How are we supposed to perceive them in general, according to you? Because, I mean, if you are testifying in a case such as the one of Senzo Meiwa, you're not just talking to the judge in court. You are talking to the people in this country. You are talking to people internationally.
Remember, the media was supposed to, this court was supposed to be on the media on that day. The former minister was addressing the media that we found the gun, there was a confession, and what it was supposed to end there. Then from there, everything was supposed to be behind the scene and then convict the guy and then come and report to the media that yeah, the guys were convicted, they found 100 life sentences, they will never come back. That was supposed to be the order of the day. Unfortunately, because of the likes of Advocate Tefu and Snowville, who they fought for this case to be televised, then everything changed. So for them, we were not part of the picture. We were going to be informed what is going to happen and what happened. But we were not supposed to see everything.
Yes.
Then now,
okay, continue.
Then now, they brought the judge. And the judge also, allegedly, of course, thought it's going to be a walk in the park. So he's got his own judgment, it's written. Even this five-year-old can see that our presiding officer, he wrote a judgment. Even if he can see, when the defense are cross-examining, he's not writing anything.
Yeah, it's not.
He has to
write something.
Yes, when it's the state, he takes notes. And then when he writes something from the defense, believe you me, he's going to ask, he's going to like, what, today, when he wrote that thing of ballistic effect, did you go to see the disease? That's what he wrote there. I will tell you, he wrote that because he could see that he didn't answer the question correctly. So what he writes there, according to me, of course, that's my opinion, he writes questions that he thinks the witness didn't answer them correctly. Then he will pretend as if he's asking clarification questions, whereas he's trying to discredit the defense lawyer.
But again, you see, in my understanding, the SAPS is an independent institution. The NPA, which brings the prosecutor such as Baloyi, is an independent institution which works in collaboration when there's a person that must be prosecuted. The police will gather the information, investigate, and then bring that information together. And then once that docket is ready, it will be given to the NPA. The NPA goes through the docket and see whether the docket can succeed before court or not. And then they take it to the court. They are taking it to the court. A court is another independent institution. that is supposed to be independent and impartial. They're supposed to look at now the fourth local stakeholders, which is the defense. They're supposed to look, the presiding judge, he's supposed to look at the defense the same way as he looks at the same way as he looks at the state, because he is independent. He does not have he is not biased. He's not emotionally affiliated or whatever affiliated to any institution, and thus the treatment must be equal, and it must be visible that the treatment is equal. At least that's my understanding on how things should be. So now looking at into this case, because I've made an example about the case in Thabo Baxter, the case of AKA, the case of the other cases, the Jacob Zuma trial, Amstel. But let me quote this one. One, I looked at the judge's interaction with the defense together with the state in the AKA matter. You couldn't tell or feel that the judge maybe is on a certain side. He was just asking questions in a manner that you could see that an independent person here is asking questions left, right, and center. Whether you are a state prosecutor or you are a defense lawyer, he is going to ask questions equally. I also saw that in the case between MK versus ANC, the trademark case, I saw the electoral court doing almost the same, right, asking questions from both of them. And so now you go into the Meiwa case, you look at how the defense is treated, and you kind of feel like, so do you mean to tell me that all these other judicial officers they are inexperienced, they don't know what they are doing? Only the one in the sense of Meiwa know what he's doing.
Yes, listen, you forgot to say they are supposed to be independent. They are not independent. They are supposed to be. Look, with this, the thing is, it's just strange. It's just unique. They run it the way how they think it should. They should run it, right? Bongani?
Mm.
Are you still with me?
Yes, I'm listening.
Yes, so now, when coming to the defense, yes, the police, NPA, JSC, they're supposed to be independent. I agree with you. They normally use this thing of saying justice must be seen,
yes,
happening,
and must be done.
Must be seen happening. If you read between the lines there, it opens the door that sometimes it's not happening, but it must be seen. So people must see that justice is happening, but we know very well that it's not happening. We know very well that police, they know Jojo very well. They know
things. Can I come in there and distract you a bit on object or I was listening to Undlozi in Parliament, Uthi, Minister of Police. You and your police are the only ones who doesn't know who is busy collecting the extortions in the communities. The community know exactly what is going on. And I was listening to that, I was like, it is interesting, because it's like only you, Minister of Police, and your police, you claim ignorance. But the people know exactly who did that. So in other words, there's a disconnect between you and the people. That's why you don't know. And then he goes on and say, the reason also you don't know is because you are part and parcel of the problem. You are working with the criminals to collect money from the communities. Continue. I'm just ending there.
Exactly. I wanted to say, he wanted to tell him that it's not that you don't know. We know that you know. But you say you don't know. First question, Bongani. Where are the police residing at? Are they coming from planet?
No.
They are staying with us, the community.
Yes.
They know who's who. That is why if there is a search, when they want to search whatever, they will quickly tell those guys, no, tomorrow we are coming, we are going to search. Put your things in order.
One guy once said, who's an investigator, he once said, we know all the criminals. If we haven't arrested you, not that we don't know you, it's just that your day hasn't arrived yet. Continue.
No one hasn't given us more money than what you gave us.
Continue.
So now, the other thing, where is this? Remember, this department are run by human beings. Right? And human beings, they are not perfect by nature. So you cannot exclude the fact that they can be tempted and be corrupt.
Wait. Right there. Pause. I'm going to take you back to Mchali, the SAP 13 guy.
Mm.
When asked certain questions, you know how he answered them? He said, I like that guy. He said, hey, you see, what you are pointing out there, advocate, it's a mistake. Remember, we are human. We make mistakes. So
exactly.
He will simply say, this is a mistake. And what I love about the guy, he will tell you, oh, yeah, this is a mistake, but according to paper, this is how it's supposed to be happening, right? And he will point to a far opposite of that. And that's why I said that's a number one most honest witness in the sense of Miwa case. That police officer, SAP 13, Mchali, that's the number one most honest police or most honest witness on the stand. So, speaking about the human imperfections, that's why I said, let me pause a bit. It then tells me that even though there are weaknesses, but when there is now intentions to create the weaknesses, then it's no longer weaknesses.
It's corruption.
Thank you. Continue.
So, yes, it's corruption. So, what I was trying to tell you now, it was, we cannot say because they are independent, therefore, what we are seeing there, it's not possible to happen. If you check the way you see the coordination that these people have been working together, these people know each other. That is why the Brigadier Kininda can simply call Mangena, say, hey, come here. And come and do 1, 2, 3. Why don't you call the office and find the administrator and say, I'm looking for the ballistic expert to come here and do 1, 2, 3 for me? Why it has to be specifically him? What if he was not around?
Oh, okay. Can I say it in my own understanding?
Yes.
You go to any of these supermarkets, Pick and Pay, Shoppers, or Spa, or whatever, you get a bad treatment.
Mm.
If I don't have the contact details of the store manager, I will then write a letter or an email to Pick and Pay. But if I have a contact details of the store manager and I am mistreated by the employees thereon, I'll take my phone and call straight the manager or the store manager. I hope you get where we're going.
Yes. So what I'm trying to say here, why did he call him specifically?
Because I've got the local the store manager's contact details directly. I can go direct to him.
If the case is assigned to him, which is something that he's going to see, but you call the registrar, somebody, the reception, the admin, that So and so, we have these people, can so and so come? And then you get the mandate from the administrator or whoever reception. Look, remember when Advocate Gomezu missed the court proceeding?
Yes.
The judge said, why didn't he call me?
Yes.
And Advocate Moshawala said correctly, no, we cannot call you directly. We must to communicate with you via the administrator.
Yes.
Why? Why? Because
you must be independent. You must not be biased. We must not have a direct access to you. Continue.
Yes, because if we call you, then you come with the judgment saying, these people, I find them not guilty. They were going to check the record, say, no, Mugomezulu talked to you on this day and he influenced you. He gave you money. Remember, they can't even get the recordings, what was said in the telephone call. It just shows that you spoke for 5 minutes. Then we don't know what you're talking about. So
and
how
what could
are you going
in 5 minutes?
Exactly. So that is why Mushola said, no. We cannot speak to you directly. We should speak to you via the registrar. The registrar has to be the one who says, no, advocate is not present. The same way when Gininde was supposed to speak to the registrar, the registrar is supposed to talk to the witness now, Mangena, say, Brigadier called and said he wants you but what is this then? Pretoria,
yeah.
North.
But here is my question again.
Mm.
So I'm just asking. I get where you're going. I'm just asking. Why do I have to write to the Pick and Pay management when I have a store manager's contact details? I might as well call the store manager and say, hey, Baba, I'm being abused by your people here. Look at what they are doing. You know what I'm saying?
Then the procedure?
I don't know. You know what I'm saying?
Why do we set the rules knowing that we don't have to follow them?
I don't know. But okay, let me answer that one. So Umangena says I was there. Meaning, if me as a lieutenant colonel I'm there, I'm the law.
That's the thing. So what happened to the integrity of the exhibit?
No. Don't think about integrity. Don't think about integrity. I am the law. That means where
no.
I am. No. Listen. I am the law. Wherever I am, there is integrity. So don't even question integrity. Because I'm the law. Where I am, automatically there's integrity.
So we have to believe you then.
Exactly.
Just,
that's what
no,
I'm saying
not
to you.
That is not how it's supposed to be done.
That when you see me, you are seeing integrity. You are seeing in transparency because I'm the embodiment of the law. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
When you see me walking, just know that everything is right. Don't even question things. You know what I'm saying? I'm just reasoning according to Mangena's statement, guys. I'm saying if you are following the logic from Mangena, it leads you there to say, don't question me. I am the law. I am the integrity. I am everything. That is right. That is the logic from Mangena.
Bongani, do you know that the barrel of the gun can be replaced?
Yes. He said, I think who was testifying on that one? Local firearm parts. I remember they said that you can replace this and this and this. This is what you can't replace because even if you do, I still remember there was a witness that testified on that.
So what if, because remember the role of the defense is to cut doubt on the evidence of the state.
Yes.
So if they say, what if the day you had the exhibit, because no one could account for that gun that you have, that was Mashololo today. No one can account in the admin that you have that gun. What if you change the barrel?
Oh,
no.
Let me say it this way. I still your car. And then, because I've heard that that's what they do, I steal your car, then I change the engine number, and I put my engine number. And then I change all the identifying marks. I don't know. They said the windows have got identifying marks as well. I don't know. But I'm just assuming it's the windows and the mirrors. So when I change all those things, I've changed the actual car, because what identifies the car has been removed. And we are left with parts that are neutral. And then we add things that will identify the car and makes it and give it a different identity. Then it becomes a different car. Thus, we put a new number plate. Then we are driving now. We are no longer driving your car. I'm driving what? My car. Because the engine number is different. All the things, all the identifying marks have been removed, and I placed mine. That is what you are saying. Continue.
That's why I'm saying, what if, because now we are talking about the integrity of the evidence, because the way he was doing things, the way he was going overboard with how you were supposed to do. His role was supposed to sit down and they bring him the exhibit, then he work on the exhibit and take it back. So he broke that procedure. Why? So now we are questioning the integrity of the exhibit that you have. Because you are a human being, like what Stain did, changed the numbers. You can also change the barrel. Make it suit you.
You know, it's very interesting what you are saying, because, I mean, come to think of it, Ramaphosa is being challenged. And when you look at the challenge there on, you're like, yeah, it makes sense. They are saying, if when you didn't take the money, the 500 billion that got stolen during COVID-19 relief, what was fun. Even if you didn't take it, as the president, you are to oversee things. So it can't be that things get stolen and you don't account. You must account on the basis of that alone. You must account. So I'm saying that is why processes are there, to protect you. Even when they say account, and then you go to processes, and then you're like, this was handled by so-and-so on this date. Here is the receipt. This was handled by so-and-so on this date. Tell me something. I'm going to ask you a question, because I keep giving this example. But let me bring you this example again. What happened in a case where you don't register these documents with the administration? On your way, in fact, let me bring a real story here. I know that Mangena drives an unmarked vehicle, but things happen. This real story will demonstrate something. Around Katlehong, there's a new mall that was built recently. It's called Semtul. A certain police officer who is in the photography department for Eguruleni Metro Police receives a call out. He needs to go. There was a crime scene somewhere. So he needs to go to that crime scene. But the shortest route was to pass through or via Semtul. But then listen to this one. At Semtul, there was a robbery in progress. They were robbing ShopRite, if I'm not mistaken. I forgot the other store. So when this guy saw the police car passing by, they shot and killed the guy, who was not even coming to Semtul, who was passing by. He was shot and killed. Tell me something. If Mangena did not do things the right way, where the administration knows that there's a gun here, what if he bumped himself into a robbery in progress, got killed, and the gun was taken? I'm just asking. How will the administration know that the police officer who got shot died with an exhibit?
He was going to be a suspect.
quite interesting.
Continue. He was going to be a suspect.
Continue. I just wanted to bring that aspect.
So now, that's the thing. That's where we are heading at. That the integrity of the exhibit is gone, and the integrity of ballistic potion is gone. Meaning, Mangena threw them under the bus. He told us that they do as they please. There's no procedure there. There's no rules. You do as you please. Somebody can just come in and take a gun and do whatever you want to do and bring it back without you knowing.
But can I bring another aspect to what they told us? They told us that police are not to be trusted, because they can steal the exhibits. That's why we have to keep the exhibits with us. That's what we learn from them. Tell me if I'm lying. Me? I'm following logic here. Logic dictates that do not trust police. If Brigadier Bongani Kininda doesn't even trust police, so much so that he will take the gun from the police, why should we trust the police on the streets, the police at the police station, if the management doesn't even trust their own?
This guy, who was the name of this guy, said that liar, Zungu. Remember, he said
with a degree in lying.
You know what he said? He said the police, we don't trust each other. We met at the parking lot when we were going to arrest Sibiya.
But why should the community trust them then if they don't trust one another?
Not us, the community. Why should Rata sit there the whole day and listen to Mangena, knowing that even his colleague, they don't trust him?
You see logic. You see when you follow logic. You see where it is lending us now. A simple statement. You see now where it is lending us. Why should we even listen to them now? Why should we
us, we can propose the way we want to propose. The main character now is the presiding officer. They are telling you as the presiding officer, or look, they were not the presiding officer. We don't trust each other because we are capable of lying. We see us, we don't trust each other. We steal guns and do whatever we want to do. So I'm here to tell you that we steal guns, and you must trust me.
You see what's funny about it is that the presiding officer still trusts them anyway. So that's the funny part about it.
He was covering the potholes. Is it the ballistic related thing to go to see the body? Because he believes. He wants to believe that this, it's not like he believes, he doesn't believe. Let us quote him correct. He doesn't believe, but he's got a work to do. And that work is to convict those guys.
Wait a minute. You know what you said now? It's very interesting, especially police who comes before court and say, do not trust us. Now, if police comes before court and they say, we don't trust each other, so here's the question. Say you want to trust one of them. Which one do you trust amongst all the police who came to the local to testify in the Senzo Meyiwa case? Do you trust Mhlahlo and you don't trust Kininda, or you trust Kininda, you don't trust Zungu? Which one do we trust? Now I'm talking for us now. Because when you were looking at it from a presiding officer's perspective, now I'm talking about us, the general. Who should we trust? Because we've already created a perception that by definition, and I always say this, and I'll say it with my chest out, the institution, SAPS, by definition, is the most important institution. It's not an institution you can undermine. It's not an institution you can underestimate, because by definition, it's the most important institution. However, the individuals working in that institution tends to corrupt the institution and thus bring the name of the constitution into disrepute. When community member says, we don't trust police, they work with criminals. And then you hear people say, no, that's not true. But police comes into, because we must believe that what they say in court under oath is the truth. And police comes under oath and say, we don't trust one another. What is there a reason or a reward for community members not to take law unto their hands when police do not even trust themselves?
Look, I wouldn't encourage to take law into our hands first.
Yes.
We should be law-abiding of citizens.
Yes.
Then your question says, who should we trust? I would say somebody who'll state the truth and not try so hard to justify irregularities. If it's improper, that person says, no, this one is improper. This is not how it's supposed to be done, but it has been done anyway. But this is not how it's supposed to be done. Then that person, he's got integrity.
Hmm.
Now, with this, coming back to this case, why are we subjected to the whole division of the police? As if like the murder was done between the shootout between the police and the civilian.
I mean, I thought you'll also say maybe at the police station, as if the murder occurs at the police station.
Because I think the people that we were supposed to they were supposed to be witnesses. It was supposed to be witness number one, maybe Kehli Khumalo. Number two, Khumalo. Number three, Zandi. And number four, Mthoko. Number five, Tumelo. Number six,
Longwe.
Number seven, Musia.
Number eight, before you get there, Mapiri. Mapiri is supposed to be among them.
Okay, Mapiri must be there. Ntabise must be there.
The neighbors, the Nasha family must be there too.
Must be there. We call Chigotwala.
Yes.
We call Longetwala.
Yes.
We call Shadrach Sibiya. We call who else? The MEC, that woman of health, because they were there. They came immediately after this. Those are the witnesses that we can call. Then the IO. Then Mangena, the ballistic expert, analyst, he says he's not an expert, he's an analyst, ballistic analyst. And then Pinky, and who else? The pathologist, the DNA, the forensic, those are the people that we are supposed, this case was supposed to, was not supposed to take 4 years.
It's interesting what you are saying, because I can guarantee you.
And then we're supposed to have, I mean, Zungu and his, what you call, 205s. All the people that I mentioned, we were supposed to have their 205s.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You know what is
then
interesting?
The 205 for the accused, if they were going to say these are the accused, then we are going to be able to link whether is it true that Zungu was with them, because it was supposed to pin Zungu and them at the same vicinity.
Mm. You know what is interesting about the long list of witnesses that you've just mentioned? Because when you were saying we should have cut all this list, it appears like, just by looking at this case, the direction in which it is taking, I can guarantee you that we are going to have another. It's probably because when I spoke to Nxumalo, Advocate Nxumalo, he suggested, I was just asking general, I said, How long do you think this thing will take? He said around October. At the time when he said that, it was the beginning of this year, I was like, we were joking. We are exaggerating. But now it turns out that even his estimation was not accurate. You know, he thought by this time we'll be done. But by the look of things, I don't know. I heard somebody say we'll finish this case in 2025. I'm going to ask you a question. Do you think that person who says 2025 is lying?
2025, which is next year?
Yes.
No, it's not. Remember, now we need to call the four experts. After the four experts, we still need to call the witness from the defense.
Yes.
Then after the, and remember, they are going to recession now, September.
Yeah, I heard. They said there's the recession from the...
On the 22nd.
Yes. I heard somebody saying that.
Yes. There is a recession on the 22nd, and then again, December, they are going to have the recession. So they are going to come back maybe October, and then they work October, November, not November, then December is another recession. So the one who says 2025... He or she might be predicting things correctly.
Because after that, they're still local. After that, once all these witnesses are called, then there are arguments again.
The other thing, don't forget that we're still going to have the ambush. We're still going to have another witness that was going to come and discredit the witness from the defense.
So, you are saying to me, we are looking at 2025, because somebody was suggesting that 2025, March, April, will be finishing this case.
Yeah, 2025, March, April, June.
You're pushing it far to June.
Yes. Somewhere around there.
I'm thinking April is even far.
With the pace, with how these things are done.
Yeah, consider the fact that the state says they are left with, I think it's four witnesses, if I'm not mistaken. And I know for a fact, and this
and
one
they are
I
not,
say...
They are, not, they are not sure.
But they said
remember,
four.
this trial is the trial of ambush.
But I'm just taking them at their word. They said four.
Remember, Sibanda couldn't even ask the question when he was asked, how many do you guys have? He said, we still have witnesses. I said, how many do you have?
He said witnesses. How many?
Witnesses.
He says, few.
Few.
And then he says, how few
there.
Is few? He says, but it's few.
Yeah, exactly. And if it was the defense who answered like that, yo, tomorrow, the second day, we are going to have a case with Rob Watt versus Mott Watt in 1928. Watt and Mamang, what day? A discreet one here. Something like that.
But again, let's assume. We're just assuming now.
Next year. Let's say next year.
Okay, I hear you. But just looking at the witnesses that are left, because when you heard Baloy, he says the witness that they were supposed to call today is very short. It's going to be a short witness as well. But I think the person who's going to spend a lot of time on the witness box
is
Gininda. Gininda is going to spend a lot of time on the witness box. And from the look of things, they want to place Gininda at the end of their of all the witnesses that they have. Because Baloye, at some point, he said that they want to place Gininda Vele at the end of everything. So, according to Baloyi, who mistakenly or accidentally said that they are left with, I think it says four witnesses from Baloyi. So minus the short witness that is coming, do you see the defense? They have their ballistic expert. There's this guy, Makubu, and it's ballistic expert Makubu and. June, you know why? Because if the witness is from the defense, then that means the person who's examining is from the state. and it's only going to be one person. That's why I was taking you through the numbers.
Yeah.
Because what prolongs time is because one witness will be examined by four counsel. So that therefore takes time. But in this case, it's going to be one witness coming from the defense who will be examined by one person from the state, and that's it. Yes, Bandage with his tactics, delay tactics, because I think it's going to be him who's going to cross-examine those people. Ooh, that guy is so disrespectful.
He's going to ask one question the whole day.
But even then, I think if we move properly, February, we should be done.
Let's say March, because February, I don't think so. Remember, there is a chance of the accused to stay, take a stand as well.
Which is not yet decided.
Yes. And remember, with Ntanzi and Musi, Sibanda took how many days each?
Hey! And asking the same question.
Yes.
Oh, now I get it. We now might have the witness, the accused, taking a stand.
Yes. Because they want to put their vision as well.
But Mnisi says it need be. In other words, it's yet to be decided.
Remember, even in the trial, within the trial, he used the word need be, and that need arised. And that's where they were saying, why didn't you tell your counsel to put your vision? Why didn't you say that? You are tailoring this thing now. It's not true.
Hey. Yeah. No, it's fine. But let me ask you my last question, though.
Yeah.
Who do you think among the council will do well in leading the witnesses? If it was according to your choice and you are saying, among all the five council, let's give these witnesses to one council to lead them. Who do you think will do a great job in leading them?
Nisi and Musholol.
Actually, I beg to differ. Ramsipile is the best in leading them. That guy is very good in covering. Did you notice how he led Ntanzi during the confession time? Trial within the time. Did you notice how he led Ntanzi?
You know why I prefer Mnisi?
Why?
He was a persecutor.
Okay.
And if you check, he knew how to put Rata in at his place quickly. He's emotionally intelligent, and he can stand his ground. Mushololo, she get irritated easily. But she can stand his ground. Mgomezulu, now he's treading carefully. He knows that he's not in good books with Rata. So he's treading, that's why he retracts, every time he retracts his questions. But when coming to Mnisi, if Mnisi asks a question, he will leave it the way it is. And he know how to put that, and he was a prosecutor. He knew what to ask and not to ask.
I'm defeated by your submissions.
Thank you, my lord.
Yeah, but here is a nugget, something to think of. Once I say this, we die. Somebody says, one day, a lot of people will be shocked to know that someone is a relative of someone or a child or, I don't know, something of that sort to someone in that court. Among the officials there, one is a close relative or is a child of someone. And to further perpetuate such, as I will say, allegedly. Chikotwala was able to hide Lamizi as his daughter until recently. And I just say, if he did it, why wouldn't others do it? Let's not be shocked at the end of this case to find that Aibo, so-and-so was the child of so-and-so. That's it. Allegedly. Goodbye.
Goodbye, my friend.
Thank you.
Sharp, sharp.